that everybody here can easily understand.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator Podcast. Your hosts, James Gable and Brandon Thompson, are here to bring enlightenment to the topic of communication.
Good morning, James.
Good morning, Brandon.
Yeah, it's still morning. Cool. We're good.
Yeah. Yeah. It's been a long morning.
Yeah, it has been a long morning, but we're still in the green zone, so let's do this.
Let's do it.
All right. Charisma or chamisma.
Chamisma?
Or charisma? Charisma.
It's not like a chorizo.
No, it's not. It's
we're
not,
talking about charisma.
Yeah, it's not what's in your burritos. It's the charisma.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, we're going to talk about charisma today. And what we're going to do, we're really going to talk about three things. What is charisma? Can you learn it and train to it? That's mm-hmm. a question that we're going to ask ourselves. And really what to watch for. There is a dark side to the idea of charisma. But what is charisma?
Charisma is compelling attractiveness or charm that can inspire devotion in others.
It really was a deeper subject than I thought. There's a lot more studies on charisma than I had expected.
Mm-hmm.
And they've done like in-person testing with a non-charismatic leader, with a charismatic leader, giving the same information to different groups of people. And they've done a lot of studies on the effect of charisma on people. The important thing for us really right now is what are characteristics of a charismatic person?
Well, I told you that charisma is just confidence.
Yeah, I remember we had that conversation just as we've been kind of talking about this week, that you're like, it's confidence.
That's all it is.
But like, no, there's more to it.
No, it's just confidence.
But there's more to it.
No, because naturally people will just follow the confident person. And you can be persuasive and other things like this, but naturally they'll follow a confident person. But if they are unconfident, they will follow the confident person. And then they see that confidence as charisma.
And I think that you are almost correct.
Well, fine.
You're partially correct. I think that definitely is a trait of a leader. A leader is going to have confidence. But talking about...
Or just a charismatic person in general.
But speaking about that, I think there's other characteristics that go along with it. Confidence, clearly number one. That is the number one trait of somebody who has charisma.
Mm-hmm.
But there's five traits that we're going to talk about today that really fit within that confidence, really being number one.
Well, so let's list off your five ingredients for charisma.
Okay, five ingredients for charisma: confidence, creativity, vision, determination, and of course, why are we talking about it? Communication.
Really? Is that why?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
This is a communication podcast.
I was getting very confused about why we were discussing charisma on a communication podcast. Yeah,
this is not a talk about the Patriots today.
I mean, it could be.
It will be, actually.
I think it can be. But so number one is confidence. And I think this is the most important kind of all these ingredients. I want to say confidence, and I also want to just say like a comfortability. Is that you're saying that? Okay. Just kind of in your own skin and in what you're doing. You can see it like early on, like kids early on gravitate towards the more athletic of the other students, right? Like those are the popular ones. If you look at the kids on the elementary school playground, right? The ones that can throw the ball the farthest or run the fastest tend to get most of the attention from all the other kids.
It's not the kid winning the chess match?
Not necessarily, no. But from there, you can develop who you are as an individual and kind of define yourself and know what you're good at, what you're not good at, and that kind of thing. And once you become comfortable in who you are and what you are, then the confidence kind of like follows that, right? Obviously, the dude that was playing chess as opposed to playing sports is not going to light it up in the sports world, but is probably incredibly confident, incredibly charismatic in the, you know, chess community. And like I said, I think a lot of confidence is just knowing who you are. And it's when you branch out from what you know and what you're good at is when you start to lack confidence, which is just kind of, that just makes sense in general, as I would say.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
Yeah. But just to give you the exact definition from the notes that we have right down here, many of the most powerful and successful leaders exude confidence. Very true. There's not too many of them that kind of like hunch over when they're speaking. And we even had a president who hid the fact that he was in a wheelchair because, it, you know, sitting down doesn't seem as confident as standing up and exuding.
Yeah, it might have been before Twitter, though.
Well, this is... the methods that they used to hide it does not matter, but the fact that they did hide it is what is important. They rarely show self-doubt and are usually in control of their emotions. That one's... that's... being in control of what's going on is also important because to be confident, you kind of, it helps to be in control, just in general.
Yep. And really, to be a strong leader, you have to practice having that self-confidence. Mm-hmm. It's a practice, right?
Yep. You can't second-guess yourself or feel shy around your colleagues, right? So you just, you're not going to back down necessarily. So I'm not saying like you won't ever back down, but you probably need to be the one that's, you know, ready to go. Be sure when leading a project to be be positive and see the glass as half full. This will help your confidence come across to your team and can lead to a positive outcome. And yeah, you know, as a leader, people are going, as a leader or someone that's charismatic, your confidence exudes, and obviously things are not going to go according to the plan, right? But they tend to look to the person that is most charismatic when things go wrong. And that's the person that tends to be the most confident in any situation, right? Like if I'm, let's say I'm at work and things kind of just break all the time or things go wrong. Like we have a bar down or something like that. Like something just went awry at work. You tend to look to the person that has the most experience and that is the most confident and charismatic in that situation and say, what should we do? As you should, as you just naturally should. I wouldn't go to the dude that's been here for 2 days and go, hey, man, so the store's on fire. What should I do?
Yeah, you got any creative ideas?
Yeah, I was that? Like, yeah, well, you just got here. Think outside the box.
And tying that into that positive positivity part as well, too, that confidence comes with a positive take that we're going to get it taken care of. And we're going to talk about the dark side of charisma. But even within that dark side, in those people's mind, they're being driven towards, in their mind, a positive outcome. They're trying to get their goals set. They may be deep, dark, wrong goals, but there is that positive outcome that people are drawn to and that confidence.
So do we want to call it a dark side to charisma, or do we want to just call it a poor use of charisma?
I'm going to call it a dark side.
See, but is it the charisma that's dark, or is it the individual that's dark?
It's the individual who is dark.
Mm-hmm.
That uses the powers endued by him or someone else in a bad way.
So it's not the charisma's fault. It's the individual's fault.
If you want to go there.
Okay.
That's fine.
But let's not blame the tool. Let's blame the person.
For sake of argument, we will.
There we go.
Blame the person.
Yeah. See, look, I just exuded charisma on James and he bowed before me.
Exude something on
Number two is creativity.
Yeah. And that creativity, I think, is huge in any charismatic leader. They're thinking of new thoughts, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're thinking outside of the box, and they're not afraid to take risks. And that's one of the things that really comes with that creativity. And I think that's these all kind of tie together. I think that's part of that confidence part too, where you're not afraid to take risks.
Oh, are we going back to how charisma is just confidence?
Mm-hmm. And then this also means that they tend to, you know, come up with these new solutions, creative solutions, and they're sharing them with the team.
Well, yeah,
when problems come up, they're good problem solvers, and that comes down to being creative as well.
Well, yeah, right. And think about it this way too. If you're just going to do what everybody else has done, you're probably not, I should say you're not very charismatic, but like you're not going to, there's nothing different about you. There's nothing that makes you stand out. And charismatic individuals tend to stand out, right? Like there's a reason why we remember the Winston Churchills. There's a reason why we remember like the Barack Obamas. There's a reason why we remember the Pete Carrolls or the Jimmy Johnsons, right? Like the people that just stand out as being charismatic, they did something different, right? You don't stand out by doing the same thing. If everybody's wearing gray and you wear gray, you're just one of the people wearing gray. Right. But if I were like, nah, I'm going to change this shirt problem and I'm going to wear hot pink, you're probably going to remember the dude that wore hot pink.
You will remember him. Yeah. That's correct. But the idea is what you're saying is that creativity sets you apart from being the norm. So that's another step within this path towards charisma.
Right. And think like you can even think about like new inventions or like CEOs that do different things like that. Right. Mark Cuban. Yeah. Owner of the Dallas Mavericks. Right. Same kind of a thing where you introduce a new idea, you come up with a different way to solve the problem. And he's a very charismatic guy. He owns a basketball team. And if I ever watch Shark Tank, he's kind of the one that I pay attention to. I don't really care about the others.
That's a good point. Yeah. And really tying that creativity into the idea of charisma, let's look at some other leaders that I think we've seen them change their charismatic level. I'm thinking of Jeff Bezos. Have you seen pictures of Jeff Bezos? That very first, this is where Amazon started. I think he, on this dot matrix computer, he printed up Amazon on it. And he's the balding guy slouched over a computer looking nerd dude. Mm-hmm. And now he's out there. He's looking like he's Indian. He's like an Indian guru now.
I was like, he's got his following. He's got the bald head and he's got
his, and his trainers and everything else. And, mm-hmm. and he does go into a room and carries a lot more charisma than I at least perceive on the pictures, just picture to picture, than he did when he started the company.
So you can just tell that something has changed.
But he super creative and really has changed the world in the introduction of Amazon.
Absolutely. So number three is vision. Leaders with great charisma are consistently looking towards the future and ways to improve it, right? They follow their goals and know exactly what they are striving to achieve. Show that you have a vision by expressing it to others on your team. If they know you're looking to improve the future in some capacity, they will take note. You have goals, right? If you're charismatic, you tend to have goals and you tend to be going somewhere, right? And you tend to have ideas and you want to share them and you want other people to join in your ideas. And we'll get to the next one, which is determination, as you already kind of said. But you're not going to rest until your goals are achieved, and you tend to need other people to achieve your goals. So you need those other people to buy into what you're saying, and sharing those ideas is charismatic.
Yeah. And it's having that view to the future, the vision idea. And when people have a view that's outside of yours, you don't know where we're going. And this person comes in with charisma and with a vision of going somewhere, then you buy into it, right? Mm-hmm. Back to your point of that, you're going to follow that person because they're going in a place that you want to go as well too, but that you have to be going somewhere. If you're just going to stand in a crowd, you're not leading anybody.
No. And it's also, and then the going somewhere, it adds to like the echelon of their character, right? Like, when you tell the story of individuals, it adds to the history of who they are, right? Like, these are the things that they have accomplished. This is the things that they've done. That builds, they become larger than just the individual, right? That builds their character, that builds their charisma, that builds their, I'm trying to think of other words for that. But, that builds their history, that, like, kind of like an ego. Right, like how an ego can almost be bigger than the individual, and not necessarily that they have a big ego, but like people perceive it that way.
Absolutely. And it goes back, let's talk about Jeff Bezos again. I think that he was able to change his persona through the course of him coming up with this idea and the teams that were built around him, and then eventually the money that he has. He built that through starting with a vision, but it built that certain persona about him that was given to him by others, and then he took on and then was, built it to another degree.
He manifested it. He had a vision maybe on a board, and then he manifested said vision.
Yes.
There you go.
That's exactly it.
The
fourth one is determination. And I think that one, it's important to have that because you have to, in order to get your vision, you have to be determined to continue to get those goals. So you have a vision, mm-hmm. you have to be adamant that you're going to fight for that vision. Be determined to get there. Don't run away from challenges, and you face them, you push on through those challenges.
Yeah, the people that have charisma tend not to back down, right? Like they're determined to achieve what they're trying to do, and they're not just going to fall in line. Not necessarily fall in line, right? But like they're not going to take no for an answer. They're here to do the work. They're here to achieve whatever they want to do. And right. Like think about like NFL players, just kind of in general, right? Like obviously they didn't just like show up and get on an NFL team. They worked hard for that. They put the hours in the gym. They watched the tape. They are determined to be successful at what they're doing. And, I would say that Tom Brady is incredibly influential and charismatic. You could say that like Shannon Sharp has a TV show nowadays, right? Like that kind of stuff.
Shannon Sharp, very charismatic.
Very charismatic, right? I think Richard Sherman is must-watch TV on Thursday Night Football whenever they do the nightcap or the halftime show.
Well, I think we talked a little bit about that style of charisma because you never know what's going to come out of Richard Sherman's mouth.
No, you don't. It's very much the reason why he's charismatic is because you're drawn to what's going to happen, right? I think it's the same reason why We watched like John Gruden. I know John Gruden might not exactly be the greatest example at this moment, but he was much like, or like John Madden, or John Gruden, right? It didn't matter. You almost had to watch football just to see what John Madden was going to do on the sidelines, because this is like a 6'6", 300-pound, just behemoth of a man on the sidelines working with other behemoths of men to win a Super Bowl. And just watching him on the sidelines was almost as entertaining as the game. And then he gets into the booth, right? And it's boom, bang,
four. And I can't do it. John Madden. That was not bad. I don't think you've ever done it publicly, and it was not bad.
Probably not. But, you know, and it might not have been audible at certain times. It might not have been grammatically correct at all. But you couldn't not listen to it. You couldn't take your eyes off it. He still, I think, has one of the largest I think it might hold the record for like most watched broadcast of a Super Bowl is when John Madden called the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
You just couldn't. You had to see what was going to happen. I think I did the same thing with Chucky when he was on Monday Night Football. I was like, what's he going to say this time? What's he going to do? You watch Pete Carroll on the sidelines, right? And this is just because I'm a Patriots fan, but one of the moments that I remember most is Pete Carroll's reaction to the interception on the sideline. Like you can't take your eyes off of it. And you can watch him celebrate with his players or not. It's a charismatic thing. And obviously he's very determined and he's not going to say no for an answer. And he thought outside the box and they went for it and it didn't quite work. Like those are characteristics of a charismatic individual.
Yeah. And we kind of sidebarred off of the idea of determination, but just wrapping determination up, the whole thing is you want to follow somebody who's not going to give up, not be a quitter. It goes back to that. And you shared that quote about if you're tired of starting over, Stop giving up.
Stop quitting.
Just keep going. And people are inspired by that. It's like, we've got this. We're going to fight through it. We got it together. Gathering the troops together. That's determination.
Mm-hmm. And then lastly, communication, because that's the whole reason why we're here. Because you can have... So you can be an individual that has this creativity, that has this vision, that doesn't take no for an answer. And you can be very confident in yourself. But sometimes if you can't properly communicate that to a group of people, it falls apart. The way you communicate is so important to being charismatic, which it sucks too sometimes, because some of the best people in the room just get ignored because they can't functionally communicate with that room.
Some of the smartest people, some of the best ideas sit in a room and die because they're not communicated. Mm-hmm. And there's a charismatic leader who might be spouting some of the dumbest ideas you've ever heard.
Oh, yeah.
And people are going to follow them because they communicated them. But one big note, I think, on the communication side is that great communicators speak in a plain language that's understood by all. And I was just talking to somebody recently about how really to reach a wide audience, you've got to talk at almost like a fifth grade level. You meet everybody. You talk it plain, simple. People will follow that. If you're talking at this super high level master's degree dissertation of sorts, that you're going to lose people. They're going to start yawning kind of like you are now when I'm talking.
Well,
you
no,
need some more coffee?
No, not quite. But it's very true, right? Like one of the most compliments, or not a compliment, but people give a lot of compliments, right? He's a simple guy. He's a straight shooter, right? He's going to give it to you. Like, you know, he's just going to give it to you how it is, that kind of thing. They're not sugarcoating anything. Just because it happened, the Jeff Saturday hiring by the Colts, right? He came in there. He's like, no, have I ever coached at an NFL level? Absolutely not. But I know I'm a leader of men, and that's what I'm here to do. And I got like six games left, and I'm gonna lead these men to the best of my ability. And if I suck, I suck. That's fine. I don't think I'd ever hear Bill Belichick sit in front of a deal and be like, yeah, if I suck, I suck. It's fine. I'm a leader of men. I can just come in here and do it. We'll see what happens. Have a good day, guys. Like, you know, that's a compliment. When people... Not necessarily dumb it down, but when people speak at a level that everybody can understand, they don't use those five-syllable words, they almost seem more convincing. Magically, exactly. Right? You know, magically. If you use a bunch of fancy words, people are like,
Yeah.
I think that's the exact reaction. Yeah.
Same response. Well, you think about somebody who is very charismatic. What's the name of that physicist guy? Very famous.
We're talking about Neil deGrasse Tyson?
Yeah, that guy, very charismatic, in my opinion. Super smart, obviously. Very studied, but he has become popular because he found social media, mm-hmm. but also because he takes these really complex ideas And he puts them in a way that we can all understand it and engage with it, and it's fun. Yeah. So what is he doing being charismatic? He's communicating at a level that is in a plain language for everybody that can understand it, and we're all benefiting and growing from it.
Yeah, and you can definitely, and you can feel the passion. The other thing that I think a lot of charismatic people, they have a passion for what they're doing, right? Like that cannot be ignored, that they truly believe, like they have a vision, they truly believe in their vision, they're confident in themselves. But the passion is there, and the passion is contagious. Like it's almost like when they like when they're voicing what they're saying, it's almost like they're sneezing into a crowd and just getting everybody infected with their own passion. So maybe that one's a little bit too close to COVID.
No, I love that representation. It's timely. That is a timely
reference.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And I think with good communicators, good charismatic leaders is really about being direct too. A lot of times in our communications, you know, for one, you're speaking plainly. We're making it simple. But let's be direct. Don't dance around. You know, it's like, where are you really going with this? You don't hear that from a charismatic leader. You know where they're going. They're being direct and they're communicating that very clearly.
Because they're confident in what they're doing. And so to ask the question, can you train charisma? I believe the answer is yes, right? You discussed Jeff Bezos as an example. Steve Jobs is another phenomenal example, right? When he was originally the head of Apple, very much like behind the scenes, like he was the dude, like kind of like a man behind the curtain in a way, where he just kind of produced this and be like, yeah, here it is. And then everybody else would like talk up his product because the product is very good. But it wasn't until Steve Jobs stepped in front of the curtain, got up and like had those releases for like the iPhone, the iPad, right? All these ideas would have been released regardless. But once Steve Jobs officially like put his stamp on it and put himself in the front and the forelight, that is when Apple really took off. When you were like, no, this is the focal head. This is the guy. This is exactly like, regardless of maybe what you thought of the product, you're just like, no, that's Steve Jobs. And that's what Steve Jobs is doing. Because he was confident in his product. He was confident in who he was. He had a vision for what he wanted the company to do. He was absolutely determined. He didn't take no for an answer. And then he would stand up and he'd give, you know, whatever TED Talks on his Apple products.
Yep. TED Talks before they were TED Talks. And there's a lot of evidence, too, that he honed and practiced those skills, mm-hmm. knowing that that was going to be the key for their success in his, you know, charismatic adventure to give us 1,000 songs in our pocket.
Yeah. So if you need assistance in being like if you have to give a speech and you're trying to be like a charismatic speaker, one of the best things I can advise is to just it's the rehearse and the prepare. The more confident you are in the material and the more confident you are when you're in what you're speaking about and the words that you're actually going to use, right? Not necessarily I can know a topic, but I don't always speak it perfectly. But if you rehearse the exact words, know exactly what you're saying, you can come off very charismatic. And it can, there's some people that can naturally just do this, right? That the words just naturally come to them. We talk about how Martin Luther King has the offhand I have a dream speech, right? We also kind of rehearsed that a couple of times, but that was the first time it had been spoken to that big of a crowd. And so there's some people that have the innate ability to pull this vocabulary and to pull these phrases from their head. That's fine. If you don't have that ability, then preparation is key. And then with preparation comes confidence. So that way you can share your creative ideas, your vision, your determination, and then you can communicate to that somebody effectively, which then creates the aura of charisma.
That aura is probably a good word that comes around that idea of charisma. You know, going backwards a little bit, charisma is a word that comes from the Greek meaning what? Divine favor.
Yes.
So they've for years have attributed this charisma idea to having some kind of, you know, divine blessing that somebody has. I have met people that seem naturally that they have it. There's some fancy pants college guy, Richard Wiseman. He teaches at the University of Hertfordshire.
Okay.
That's another one of your British fellers, right?
Yeah.
But anyways, he states that, or he estimates that charisma is half inborn, half acquired. I don't think that's based on science. And now that we've really dove into this a little bit, I don't think it's half. I don't think you have to have half charisma to be considered charismatic, inborn. Mm-hmm. I think there's plenty of skills that come along with it that will draw out, you know, stuff that's inside of you that you might not have known. But there are definitely people that have it naturally.
Well, that's a, so this is kind of a new phenomenon that I've discovered at work. There's this girl named Alexia that comes in, and she wears heels. She's probably like close to 6 feet tall. She comes in and she's wearing like 3-inch heels. So she's like 6'3" tall. She's a very attractive woman. And there's not too many times that I watch people just like interact with other people, especially at work, cause I'm kind of doing it. So everybody in my store will make sure to say hi to this one individual.
Really?
And it kind of flabbergasts me a little bit. And this is not to take away from her. Like, it's not like she's a bad person or anything like that, but she just walks in and immediately, like, everybody pays attention to her. That's that, like, inborn charisma. And part of it's just because she's an attractive human being and she's very nice. She's very pleasant.
Yeah, but she's exuding something. You had another word for it. What was it?
What?
Not it's it. It was.
There's an aura?
No, you instead, they have it. What did you call that?
When they call it, they call it the bee's knees. The
it. When you talked about somebody having the it.
Yeah, that's it.
That's it.
Yeah, that's it. I guess she just has it. And I'm not over here saying that, like, I dislike her for having this or anything like that. But it's just, I don't often watch and see that kind of happening. And I don't think other people see that. Or, you know, I don't think they see exactly what I'm seeing. And it's funny just how, like, that is the magnetism that charisma has. And I think that one's naturally born. But if you don't have it naturally born, right, because some people just suddenly do, it's a tool that you can train and use. And I think a lot of that comes from the preparation and that kind of a stuff behind it, right? Like, you have to, some people don't have to think about it. If you don't have natural charisma, you just have to think about it. You just have to be in the moment. You have to be paying attention. You have to be ready to go. You have to have your drive, your determination, your communication skills ready to go, because you need to think about what you're doing and then you need to act on it. Where others it's so stupid how things just come naturally, because there's no way to describe that it comes naturally, right?
Yeah, and it's a combination of looks, presence, how they, I mean, there's a whole bunch of things that come in that give people that kind of, when movie stars walk in a room, they come with an entourage or whoever it is. There's some people have that ability to draw. I've heard that was the case with Bill Clinton. When Bill Clinton would come into a room, he would electrify these rooms just with walking into these. And so he had that charisma as well, too. That was just innate, born in him. And you know, he was one of those guys, goes back, I don't know if it's determination, but he would have energy for days and nights. He would just go.
Yeah, no, and I feel like that's part of like the vision, right? Like, you just knew that dude walked in with purpose, with a vision, and his energy for that purpose and that vision and that determination is that charisma aspect. And that's the kind of things that you can work on and you can believe in and that you can have if you are trying to train confidence. Or not confidence, if you're trying to train charisma.
Train charisma, exactly. Well, I think you train confidence too. So
that was a good you definitely do train confidence.
But to finish up with this fancy professor from Hertfordshire, England, says there's really three qualities that he says is part of a charismatic leader. And one, feels emotions very strongly. You talked about passion, right?
Yep.
That's important. They feel emotions very strongly. And they can excite them in others. People buy into their passion. And then the third thing, and this is going to tie into the other side of charisma, is he's impervious to the influence of other charismatic people.
You can't be a leader if you're a follower.
You can't be charismatic if you're always going to be following somebody else, is what you just said.
Yeah, like, I just, that doesn't happen. I don't ever remember a time where a leader's giving a speech and I'm like, yeah, dude, that dude on the left in like seat 3, row 7 was so charismatic during that speech.
But I think there is a little bit of, we hang around charismatic people. And there is some of that comes off on other people when they're around other ones who aren't with that person, then they become that charismatic person to a different level. So I think there's a little bit of learned charismatic, but if you put them all in a room, one of them is going to come to the top.
It's going to be like the alpha charismatic person.
Correct.
I was like, because I should say I steal from other people, but I'm like, oh, I'm going to take that. I'm going to take that. I'm going to use this. This is going to be a quote here, that kind of a thing. And then it just kind of builds up who I am as an individual, but it's an amalgamation of a lot of other things that can come from different locations.
Well, so let's, as a following up here, we're going to close on talking about the dark side of charisma. I'm now going to change my opinion.
Dark people of charisma, or the dark people that have charisma.
Nope. I'm going to stick with my original plan,
uh-huh,
which is the dark side are the people that are induced by somebody else's charisma. That's mm-hmm. the dark side that we have to be aware of, because what they found that being impervious to the influence of other charismatic people is that when, as part of these studies, they found people that are around those that are charismatic, they tend to suppress their emotions. And this was all part of the study that they were showing, that people will hide their emotions in check when this other person is interacting with them. They don't become as important as what it sounds. And also they become, this is that kind of awestruck idea. So that's, I think, the dark side of it, is to not be in that position where you're so awestruck by somebody. There's a guy that speaks on a TED talk that went and saw Obama speak. And he was, you know, he got there 3 hours early. There's 200,000 people. This is before he was elected president. 200,000 people come to show up and listen to Obama speak in Germany. Mm-hmm. And he's waiting there. He's talking to this individual. And then he gives a speech, and she's, tears are coming down her face. She's just super emotional about the whole thing. And he's in that front row experiencing that with him. Well, Obama does happen to come by and sees her, kind of ignores him a little bit, shakes his hand, moves on, and gives her a hug, and he gets a picture of all this, and you can see this on YouTube. But the idea is, he asked after, he says, what were the 3 points? Like, what was so moving about that? And she goes, it was just the whole thing. She could not really pinpoint exactly what it was that she got from Obama during that experience, but it was just something that she got. And ultimately it was, her emotions were pretty much suppressed in there, that she was just so awestruck by what had happened. And that's the power that charismatic people have over other individuals.
They do. So use it wisely.
Use it wisely?
Yeah.
Be careful with it. But I would say just be cautious of it when following, because that's when the dark people of charisma, so I'll agree with you, they're dark people, David Koresh's, there's been people that have led other people, Jones, down in Guyana, Jim Jones. These people had such a negative influence with their charisma over people that people followed them, and that they just did some terrible things with them because they were drawn in. They were awestruck mm-hmm. by them.
Yeah.
So that's the side that we would caution the uncommon communicator to do, is just be careful that those are things that can happen with really overly charismatic people who are going the wrong path,
mm-hmm.
using it incorrectly,
yep.
as you say.
Yep. So to answer the question of nature versus nurture, as far as charisma is concerned, we're going to kind of split it a little bit 50-50, but we're also going to tell you right now that you can train it.
You can train it.
There are some that have it naturally, but we're here to tell you right now, you can train it. Confidence is key. And know your stuff.
Yeah. And I think that's, if there is a UC moment, I think that one is the number one thing that you've already pointed out,
confidence
is key.
So UC moment is confidence is key?
That's correct.
All right.
That's all I got.
See you. Bye.